been a question asked by the philosophers, poets, and even laymen. So if you analyze literature, you can see that for a philosopher, just like Descartes or like Voltaire, almost all of them said that animals are without any mind. They don't have any mind, or they don't have any soul, or they are not thinking anything. They are just automatons, just like a machine. They react towards the simplest constructor. A recent study conducted by Kutsala et al. On Finland, Finnish people, they also found that the laymen of that area don't believe that animals possess any sort of cognitive abilities. So they analyzed how they see the farmed animals. They found that they are considering the farmed animals as just the automatons. They don't have any feeling, anything like that. So if you analyze the literature, you can see that the poets, especially and some biologists, and many laymen like us, always believed that there do exist some remnants of mind in animals. For example, our own study, which we conducted among the school children in Kerala, we found that most of them believe that animals also have emotions like us, or at least they feel pain like us. So all these things ended up in a big question like, what is like to be a bat, which was asked by Nagel. So as you know, if you analyze, you can ask the question to what is happening in the mind of your dog, which is your pet, and what is happening in the mind of the fish, which is kept inside the aquarium into your home. So there are two methodologies to study the animal mind. One is analogy methodology, in which all animals already I know have a mind, have the property X. Then individuals of species have property X, and therefore individuals of species Y probably have a mind. This is the analogy method used in animal cognition to study, and which was promoted by many of the scientists in this field. And the second methodology is the best scientific explanation methodology. So in this methodology, individuals of species X engage in behaviors Y. So the best explanation or best scientific explanation for such an individual engaging in behaviors Y is that it has a mind. So in this case, there are behaviors which will be very difficult to be explained using associative models, which is common in animal cognition or animal behavior studies. So there is also, so here also, therefore, we also reach a conclusion that therefore it is likely that individuals of the species X have minds. Okay, let me put it there. So what is an animal? As all of you know, there is about 1 million species of animals are available on the planet Earth. And it is believed that up to 2050, there will be about 7 million animals to be recorded. All of them are different in their morphology. As you know, fishes are fishes, men is men, and crow is crow. And you can see some of them are round in shape, some of them are laterally compressed, some just like fishes, some of them are dorsolaterally compressed, just like us human beings. Yeah, bread for embodied cognition people, you can think about that in animals also. So similarly, there exists variation in the biology also. Some of them are egg-laying, some of them are lonely living, some of them are social, some of them are living in groups, like that. And the ecosystems they live also is different. For example, some of them are living in water like fish, some of them are living in on plants, some of them are living inside the water, inside the mud. So similarly, the role played by that animal in that ecosystem is also different. So different species of belongs to living in different ecosystems have different role to play. Yeah, we can ask, so yeah, this is the common thing which we can see in any sort of biological textbook, and what is the relevance for us, the cognitive scientists, about this? So if you analyze, you can see that very, very few number of species has been studied for the cognitive abilities. And most of the studies has been chimpo-centric, as Beck said, most of the concentrated on chimps and monkeys. All the other non-expert species like fishes, some other species like rough frogs, toads, salamanders, they haven't been studied at all. So recently, when this during the cognitive evolution which happened in the 1960s, what happened that people started to think about animals also. And they started to analyze the animal community also using the tools which has been used to test the cognitive abilities of human beings. So if you analyze an animal, you can see a similarity sandwich, which was proposed by Wine, Clyde Neil Wine, who is a very famous animal cognition researcher. So in periphery, they are different. All of us know animals are different from us in the morphology and all that thing. But if you go a little bit more deeper, you can see that they are like us. They also drink, they also eat, they also show aggressive behaviors, they also fight like us. But if you go further deep, you can see much similarity between us and animals. And you can't see any animal conducting a workshop on human cognition and talking like this. So they are different from us in that case. So Brouwer said that it, as far as the cognition is concerned, there is it appears like a similarity sandwich. So like us has been embedded in between not like us, two not like us. So the current talk, what we will do that we will analyze these things in detail. And in this session, what we will do that we will follow the methodology of a behavioral scientist, just like an animal behaviorist who follows behavior rather than cognition. And we will slowly move towards the cognition in the next talk. So there will be a slow transition from behaviorism to the cognitive science or cognitivism in animal. So, as you know, the cognition or whatever it may be, whatever behavior is started in sense organs. Sense organs are windows to the world, and through which the animals or whatever the system be there, it gets information about change in the environment. So we can see that if you analyze animals, they possess many of the senses which we human being can't sense. So their brain may be different. For example, olfaction, which is one of the most primitive sense. Because as you know, life has initiated in the water. So in water, the most effective medium of communication is olfactory communication. So if you analyze, you can see that there are two types of olfactory communication available in animals. One is smell and the other one is pheromones. So smell, in our case, human beings case, the amount of or the number of smells we can perceive is very low. So you just think about a shark or a dog which develops a cognitive map or a map of its surroundings using smell. In the case of PGM, what they do that they migrate at home using the smell. Even though there are studies which shows that there is variation in European PGM as well as in American PGM which is using the smell, but they also develop cognitive map using smell. And salmon, you may know salmon migrates from the river, from the sea, first it migrates from the river to sea and then it comes back, also uses this olfactory clues to navigation. Another thing is pheromone. Pheromone is a very rare case in the case of human beings. But you can see insects, rodents, and dogs using pheromones at very high level. So what you can see that in insects, the definition of pheromone states that. So it's a chemical which initiates behavior in another organism of its own species. So you can see in the case of rodents, there is a very famous example known as Bruce effect, in which what happens that when a rat gets inseminated by another by a male rat, and before the implantation, if it gets a pheromone of an alien male, the embryo will be spontaneously aborted. So such involuntary things also can happen with this type of pheromones. So in the case of dogs, you will have seen the dog standing with the tail in between the legs. So have you ever thought why it is doing that? It's because when the dog reaches a condition where there is no familiarity or no stress, there is a gland behind near its annual aperture which produces a pheromone. And it's an open signal to the all other dogs to turn away from there. So in order to show that it is not stressed, what it do that it blocks the pheromone production using the tail. Similarly, humans also have pheromones in a very low condition. It's known as Wellesley effect. Some of you may be familiar with that. What happens that in the case of human beings, especially in the case of human females who lives in a group, the menstrual cycles get synchronized due to the pheromones. It was discovered by Martha McClintock in Wellesley College, so it's known as Wellesley effect. So it is found that unknowingly the behavior, especially the hormone status of the ladies, are getting changed when they are kept in groups. The same thing has been seen in hostels, jails, and other things. So you can see even the pheromones and hormones and the smell can vary the behavior of an organism, including human beings. So next, let's move to the next sense, that is vision. Vision is different in animals. So if you go to insect, you can see the two bone-like things which you are seeing is an eye of an insect. It contains thousands of ocelli, small eyes. And it develops an image which is similar to that of which we see through in creature. So we don't know in what way the insect is perceiving the world through its eyes. So each of these small eyes creates an image and which is perceived by the organism. So next comes spiders. I'm just going through different examples and showing that animals are different from human beings in the different senses or the way in which they perceive the world. The spiders have 8 eyes. So we know we have only 2 eyes and we are using the 2 eyes for all these things. In the case of spiders, there are side eyes, which gives a blurry wide angle image. And there are middle front eyes, which gives a clear focus telephoto color image. And there are side front eyes, just the distance to the prey. So the way in which a spider sees a prey and do its behavior is entirely different from that of human beings. So it's using different sense, different eyes to get an image of the animal or the prey which is in front of it. The next one, another thing you can see that we can see only three colors. We are trichomes. But in the case of many other animals, they have four color cones in their eye. For example, fishes, insects, etc. can see ultraviolet lights also. And in the case of guppies, the fishes, yeah, they are my bone system, so that you will get more examples from fishes. But they do that, this measures the amount of ultraviolet radiation coming from the males to select best mate. So while selecting the males, females, what they do that, they measure the amount of ultraviolet rays coming from the males, and then choose the males which is producing more amount of ultraviolet light. And recently it is found that in certain cases, in certain stripes as well as in certain females, they can see ultraviolet a little bit. So they are also trichromacy. They also show trichromacy. So it's interesting how they are perceiving color and how we are perceiving color. We have to compare that in future also. So there are another animals, that is snake, they can see infrared. They can see the red color infrared, that is the heat produced by the other organisms. So if you even blind a snake, what can do, what can happen, that you can see its brain using this infrared rays produced by that animal. So in this case, we can see there is an organ known as heat pit, which is just seen below the rostrum of the animals, using which it senses the heat produced by the brain. And it is directly connected to the pygidermal nerves, and it senses the variation in the heat and captures the brain. So another thing only brain, the first thing we are going to do is that we are just seeing that what are the different senses that I will see, as we said. So we can see another thing is in the case of body brain, there are ultrasonic communications. So bats, what they do that they use ultrasonic sound. So if a bat is moving above your head, it is producing ultrasonic sound, but we are not able to hear that. Bats use this sound to echolocate, to locate an object, to recognize an object, and to catch a prey. At the same time, it was discovered by Donald Griffin, who is considered to be the father of, or one of the biggest icon in the field of animal cognition research. So another case is that is infrasonic. There are animals which produce infrasonic sounds. That also we can't hear. So you will have heard about elephants communicating with each other. The elephants which is traveling in long distances, what they do that they produce infrasonic sound, and using the type of that they travel. So they communicate through infrasonic sound. Whales also produces infrasonic sound. Because using the infrasonic sound, they communicate, especially to call mates. Another thing they do is that they use this infrasonic sound to catch its prey. Suddenly they will make a burst of infrasonic sound, and the prey will be faded down and will catch that. So similarly, insects, so, yeah.
What is the difference between ultra and infrasonic?
We can hear up to, from a range from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So because below 20 kHz it comes under the infrasonic category. And above 20 Hz it comes under the kilohertz comes under the ultrasonic level. So both of the sounds we can't hear and we can't sense. So another thing is that that insects also produces ultrasonic sound. What they do that bats are the major enemies of insects. So when a bat comes to attack an insect, what it will do that it will also produce ultrasonic sound, to jam the sound produced by the bat. So in the auditory communication also, they are much different from us. So next one is gustatory taste. So you will be feeling it, sometimes you may not know that your cats, especially the canids in your home, can't sense sweet. So in canids, there is no sense for sweet. But they do that, but there are certain other canids who eat meat as well as fruit. They can sense sweet, but the common canids found in our area, like tiger, like cat, can't have the ability to sense sweet. So similarly, dolphin is missing bitter flavor. Dolphin can't sense bitter feeling. And sea lions also can't have umami, that's a savory taste. So similarly, nowadays the animal systems are available to study the taste perception using fishes' medulla. You can get blind, taste blind medulla, and you can change the sense and all that things to understand how animals get the sense of taste. So under this discourse of rat and barbels of fishes, what they do that they use a different system to navigate and to understand the world. The rat uses its discourse for orientation, navigation and balance, and in shorter distance it uses its discourse to measure the depth. Other case of catfishes also, what they do that they have barbels, and using the barbel that is the right thing, they get sense of the world, and it's using this they can even survive and they can even get the prey in the dark conditions. Another sense which is not common in human beings is proprioception. So what certain animals like lamprey, they are fishes, usually it is used by fishes. What they do that, they use electric impulses to sense the world. So in, there are studies which shows that one fish, one electric fish can recognize another electric fish using an electric impulse. So they communicate using electric impulse, and it will be like just like we communicating using the shock. So mild shock. That system also we can't understand, human beings can't understand. Similarly, you can see lateral in fishes. There's another sensor called lateral in fishes. What they do that they just get the variation in the pressure in the water using this lateral. So we can't never see feel unless if there is a big wind that we, what is happening in our pressure of our medium in which we are suspended. So the question becomes more complex. What is likely to be a part of it maybe? So there are 1 million species. You have to ask what is likely to be, what is likely to be, what is likely to be. And it shows very different sense organs and sensor systems. So we can expect difference in them also. So similarly, here comes the concept of qualia. As you know, as you people know, qualia is the personal experience. So we can say that how the bad or how the animals is experienced in the world, we can't say anything because we can't expect that, experience that qualia. But we can do that, we can use the methodologies which is used to test the cognitive abilities and other abilities in human beings in these animals, and we can check whether they also possess these abilities. That's the only methodology which we can do to analyze the cognition in animals. So as we have gone through a little bit about the perception or the different perceptive mechanism by the animals, now let's move to the, yeah.
Could you explain
what's
qualia?
Pardon?
Could you explain what's
qualia? Qualia. Qualia is the subjective feeling of certain things, whatever you are experiencing. For example, if you are seeing this as white, whatever you are feeling is qualia. Because your, the white which you are seeing may be or may not be the same white I am seeing. So it's a personal experience of the stimulus. So what, when a fruit is seen by a bat, what it feels and what, even though we say that using the methodologies of behavior science, this is like that, that is like that, we can't say what actually the bat may be feeling, if it is feeling. Shall I continue? So, up to this level, what we said that they are not like us, or there is marked variation between them and us. So, in the current system, in the current section, what we will test that whether there is any similarity between us. For example, this is a quote taken from famous book of Charles Darwin, The Descent of Man and Selection in Relation to Sex. So, Darwin, the famous biologist, starts with like this. My object in this chapter is solely to show that there is no fundamental difference between man and the higher animal in their mental faculties. So Darwin states like that there is continuity and humans are nothing but a naked ape, just like this one said. So he continues, difference in mind between man and the higher animals, great as it is, certainly one of the degree and not of kind. So he always believed that whatever we are seeing now has undergone evolution from the microscopic organism and developed into a complex system or complex system of adaptation called mind in inverted comma, because in animals we are using mind in inverted comma. So what? So in the next slide we can see that there is another scientist who is one of the pioneers of animal behavior, Washburn, who is the first lady to got PhD in psychology, and she was also an animal behaviorist. She says that our abundance with the mind of animals rests upon the same basis as our abundance with the mind of our fellow men. Both are derived by inference from observed behaviors. So she says that if in the case of qualia, we can understand what is happening in the mind of someone who is sitting in front of me, and what is happening in my, similarly we can understand what is happening in the mind of the pet which I am carrying. So she again continues, the action of our fellow men resembles our own, and we therefore infer them like subjective states to ours. The action of animals resembles ours less complexly, completely, but the difference is one of the degree, not the kind. So there were many animal behaviorists who believed that the difference between an animal and a human being is in degree, not in the quality. So they just believed that there is a continuity of mental faculties from bacteria to human beings to evolution. So if you analyze further, you can see that basic psychological processes are similar in animals and human beings. They also learn, and they also learn uses different similar mechanisms to learn. They also remember, they also recognize familiar from unfamiliar. Then the basic sense of time and number is also similar. They also use the symbolic system, and they also follow the Weber's law. And this list of the similarity between animals and human beings is growing every day. And if you analyze, if you just check the nature for the last 5 or 6 years, you can see at least a new faculty has been added to this list. Nowadays, it is going for culture, cognition, and all that part. And even recently, Kevin Leland published a paper titled "Fish from Fish to Fashion." So this system operates in similar way. So Darwin argued that just like genetic continuity, there is mental continuity also. And basic building block of nervous system, as you know, the behavior is produced and controlled and processed by the nervous system, has also similarities. Almost all of them use similar neurotransmitters, and the physiology and blood mechanism is also almost similar. So the question comes, can we call the continuity of life as continuity of cognition of mind again? So from here onwards, we are moving towards the systems followed by animal behaviorists. So, what we are going to do is, we are going to analyze these community abilities or behaviors using the lens of biology. So in biology, behavior is nothing but the response of the system or organism to various stimulus or input. Whenever an input comes, whether it reacts or not reacts, and it is called as behavior. If it is reacts, it's called as behavior. So in animals, even though they have very higher level order cognition, the output can be only the behavior, because animals can't talk to us whether what they feel. So here we are following the behaviors. So according to Steven Sitchell, the behavior is developed or formed inside the mind or the so-called mind of the animal. Unless it moves into an action, unless it is converted into an action, it's a useless thing, because nothing will happen if the action is kept inside the mind. So using this technology, these things we are moving next, we are moving forward. So in biology, as you know, nothing makes sense except in the light of evolution. The famous spirits by Dobzhansky. Whatever it may be, or whatever behavior, whatever morphology, whatever life cycles we are studying, it makes sense only if you use the theories of evolution on that. So very simply, I am not going for a detailed explanation of evolution. The very simple thing is that evolution is defined as any change across successive generation in inherited characters of biological population. This variation could be behavior, the variation could be life cycle, or variation could be morphology, but behavior is more susceptible to change in any system. So there is a famous theory that is by natural selection, put forward by Darwin. And there are other systems, external also inheritance and culture, that we will discuss later. So, in an evolutionary cognitive science, there is a system which says that when the nervous system of a species attains a sufficient level of complexity during evolution, it's believed that some types of behavior become indicators of animals' ability to form and act upon structured internal neural representations. So as you know, the cognitive ability starts with the formation of mental images. What the animal or the organism does that, it makes its own replica of the world around it. So for this, as we know, for this, the analysis of biology and the comparison of different animals shows that there should be a little bit of complexity in the nervous system, or only at a certain level of complexity of nervous system, this type of mental images or the formation of mental images thing like this. Okay, so let's, before entering into the animals, as you know, the talk is titled Cognition in non-human species. As you know, there is about 1 million species, but we are going to do that. We will just know what are the different animals, or just the representatives of different animals, and we will test what are the behavior or cognitive abilities they possess. So biology, the best tool or the most efficient tool used by biology is comparison. It compares different animals, different things and all that things. So the comparison, and after taking comparison, it leads to deduction or induction, whatever it may be. So the basic tool is comparison. So based on the complexity of the organism as well as the time of evolution, the animals can be classified in many classes. So the lowermost one can be protozoa. You may know some of them. Amoeba, Euclidean, which you have studied in your basic classes. And another one is polymera, the sponges, the next level of organism, which stays on a place and collects the food. Then comes the cylindrate, that is hydra or corals, which are other organisms, which are the next level organisms. And evolution becomes further complicated, and you can see worms, the nematodes, which is our, and then it comes annelids, that is earthworms and relatives. Then comes our other organisms, just like shrimps, insects, and crabs. So next comes mollusks, the shell-living organisms, or organisms which have shells, like conch and all that things. And next to that comes echinoderma. This is just to think that I am going for 500 biologists and deeply biologists, just to give some idea about the way in which a biologist perceives the cognition or biologist sees cognition. And then it moves further, and you can see hemichordates, that is the organism with the spinal, with the remnants of spinal cord, and then comes fishes, amphibia, that is frogs, toads, and salamanders. Then come reptiles, then come birds, then come mammals. Then in mammals, you can see the it becomes further complicated, monkeys, apes, and man. So you can see from a microscopic organism like Euglena, the life becomes complex and complex and complex and reaches up to the human beings. This is the way in which evolution explains the complexity acquisition of the life. So what you can see that we are expecting the similar complexity, the variation, the complexity in the nervous system as well as in the behavior of these animals from protozoan to human beings. So let's compare that. So initially, let's start with the nervous system. So don't be nervous, we are not going for an internalist of nervous system because there are people from different backgrounds as we discussed now. Because each of you are from, I hear from our friends that you are, there are people from biology background, there are people from language background. So it will be difficult for you people to move in the same direction, even in the same pipeline, even though it is, our target is the same thing, the cognition. So let's move to the next thing. What we can see that these are the neurons, which is the basic building block of behavior. So what neurons does that? It senses or it receives the variation in its environment in the form of impulses. So you can see basic types of neurons. One is unipolar neuron, which is the basic thing, basic component of any sensory organs. It perceives the changes happening in its environment. Then it gives this to bipolar neuron, which is an intermediate between motor neuron or a processing neuron, just like that neurons find in the brain. And then there are other neurons, that is motor neurons, which reacts or which forms the behavior. And there are cerebral cells or the complex cells inside the brain which process this data. So these are the complex the basic structure of neurons. And you can see the there is variation in the neurons. You can see most of them have been seen from the lowermost element to the highermost elements. So if you analyze pointers, so in protozoan there is no nervous system, they are using ion channels for the communication. So if you have these pointers, you can see a condition which is almost resembles the nervous system. So it produces chemicals like a nerve, and they communicate between the nerves, communicate between the cells using this type of chemicals. Then comes, if you analyze, you can see that the nervous system gets connected and it forms a network and it connects each other using synapses. It's also a very fundamental thing we are talking. Then the synapses develop into neural network. So if you analyze the complexity, you can see that on the upper level is Hydra, which is a cylindrate, which develops a nerve net. There is nothing, different nerves has been connected in the form of a net, and the organism receives stimulus from different parts of the body. So there is no brain or anything like that. But if you move to the next animal, that is a helping or a worm, you can see cephalization. The nervous system gets more complexity and it develops a form to develop a nerve cord, and it is again connected, and a head, the formation of head starts. So you can see it, you will see some ice cord like thing and a small cluster of neurons in the top. So that's known as ganglia. So the nerve cells accumulate in the form of a ganglia, and the ganglia start to be prominent in earthworms. As we said, they are above the worms. Then if you move further to an insect, this is the section of cockroach or the nervous system of a cockroach, you can see that this is further complicated. It gets more and complicated, and the number of ganglia also increases. You can see brain-like things on the head region. But when it moves towards next level, that is molluscs, you can see almost a system like a nervous system and a brain. A pseudo brain-like thing or that much big accumulation of ganglia you can see. And as you know, many of these animal cephalopods, like in which the octopus belongs to, shows many cognitive abilities. So that we will discuss tomorrow, how the different advanced level cognitive abilities are distributed among animals. So the next one is sea stars. There is also the system is very complex, there is the central nervous system and other abilities. So if you move forward, you can see that when it leads to vertebrate, the brain becomes further complicated. So in fish, you can see it's very, that midbrain region is very high. And as it moves downwards through frog, alligator, shrew, and birds, what you can see is that the cerebral cortex, the area which is considered to be the place where the cognition and the higher level cognitive abilities are being located, becomes further and further and further and further complicated. So in the next slide, you can see the variation in the brains of mammals. Just some mammals. The starfish shrew, which is the lowermost mammal. You can see there, the first slide, you can see it's almost smooth. There is no variation, there is no sulky or gray, right? So once you move downwards, when it reaches to monkeys, you can see it becomes more complicated. It accumulates more in sulky gray, it means it accumulates more neurons and more neural connections. So further, the last slide, you can see that of human beings. The cerebral hemisphere is already covered our brain almost. So this complexity acquisition can be seen connected with cognitive abilities also. If you analyze, you can see that the animals like dolphin, also, which is considered to have higher level of cognitive abilities, you can see there, their cerebral cortex is also complex. Another thing, dog, here also you can see cerebral cortex is complex. And when it comes to the case of chimpanzee, so it was like that of human beings. So tomorrow we will analyze how human brain is different from chimp brain, or what is the major difference between chimp brain and the human brain also tomorrow. But here you can just see the variation, how different are the different brains even belongs to the. And one more interesting thing, you can see the variation according to the environment. You can see that the dog brains. So there are two brains I have shown. One belongs to one dog which lives in the jungle region. It has a jungle region, and another is a dog which is variety which is usually kept inside the home. You can see the variation in the complexity of the brain. The sulky and gray are different. And less the complexity, you can see the dogs which is getting very less stimulus. So that's why we develop two brains. So here you can see the acquisition of complexity is also correlated with the cognitive abilities. So from the lowermost animals, as we see, the nervous system started. It started to get the information from its surroundings. Then what happened? The processing became more difficult because the system became more complex. Then it started to appear more and more and more and more and more neurons and more and more and more cognitive abilities. So now let's move to the next slide. So in evolution, there is another very interesting topic, which is called string adaptation theory. It says that ontogeny repeats phylogeny. You will be familiar, previous people may be familiar, because this theory has been proposed by a pharaoh. So what this is used in biology also. If you analyze, you can see that an organism's embryonic stages are similar to the embryonic stages of other organisms. You can see in the case of human beings, the brain getting complexity. So in third week, this is just like a tube. And once the organism develops more and more and more, you can see it's getting more and more and more and more complexity, means that the embryo is getting more and more and more cognitive abilities. Okay, let's move to the next level. So if we start to, so we have analyzed the system which is producing behavior. Now let's move to the system which is, now let's move to the behavior itself. So whenever we talk about the animal's behavior or the cognitive abilities of animals, biggest criticism always comes in front of us is anthropomorphism. So people believe that if we start to say that monkey also does this, fish also does this, people say that no, you are just anthropogenizing that, you are just comparing that. So there's a famous famous theory by Wilson, which says that biophilia, the urge to affiliate with other forms of life. We all have an urge to affiliate with other forms of life. If any of you have a formal training in neuroscience, you would have seen that when two cubes are moving, it's a standard experiment, we start to attribute the human-like characters for that if you're insulizing and amygdalized impact. We try to provide them with personality and social things. So similarly, that is one of the biggest criticisms said against the anthropomorphism. So, but in that case, what happened that Lloyd Morgan has proposed a very big theory. So he proposed that in no case may we interpret an action as the outcome of the exercise of a higher physical faculty if it can be interpreted as the outcome of the exercise of one which stands lower in the psychological scheme. So if you can explain a behavior using very fundamental things, you have to explain that. You need not to go for higher level cognitive ability to explain that. So if an animal works like some way, you can just, if it is possible, you have to explain it using the theories of computational science or something like that, or computational theory of mind. Or unless a condition comes where you can't use any association or associated learning theory, you can only use this cognitive, the term cognitive and mind in inverted comma. That was the custom of animal behavior until 5 to 8 years back. So whatever they found, whatever they got, they tried to convert in the form of a behaviorist explanation. So nobody was there to say that animal also has a mind, and then if somebody says also, it's very difficult to recognize. Another problem seen here is that of anecdotes. Only very few animals do this behavior, and you can't do just like a physical experiment or a chemical experiment. All animals should do this. That's not possible with animals. So mirror these cognitive abilities, just like you have heard about the just like the tool making or all that things. Very few animals does that. All of them never do that. So there was a problem because almost all of these biologists also were following the theories of statics and all that things. They said that if it is an anecdote, it's very we can't publish it and we can't keep it as an anthropomorphic. We should keep it as an anthropomorphic things. So it became more with modern canon and the people started to work in that way. So we will start with that system and solve the motor recognition as we said, which happened in the behavior science also. So we start with the simplest behavior seen in animals, that is kinesis. So if you take a bacteria or if you take a protozoan or a very, very novel animal in the evolution, major behavior what you can see is kinesis. If there is a stimulus, the organism will show some non-directional movements. So for example, if you just introduce a light stimulus or a chemical stimulus in a protozoan culture, what it will do that either they will come towards this or they will just disperse to different things. So you can see many of the photophobic animals what they do that when you give this light, suddenly they disperse to different places. So there is no direction, there is no complexity, one switch, one behavior, simplicity. So similarly in an organism with the nervous system, you can see a reflex. In our case also, we can see reflex. Suddenly, if there is a stimulus, just like a clicking or a heat or something like that, it just shows a random movement, just a random behavior. So here, as you know, this reflexes are involuntary. You need not to be conscious to move your hand. You need not to have intentionality to move your hand. It's just a reflex. So if you analyze, you can see that the system, is slowly acquiring complexity in its behavior also. So in the next level, what we can see that next comes taxis. Here, the reaction will have a direction. Either the animal will come to the stimulus or the animal will move away from the stimulus. So if there's a stimulus, based upon the, it's also hardwired, it's also not a learned behavior. Whatever the thing be, what happened that animal, if you provide a stimulus, either it will come towards the stimulus or it will move away from the stimulus. So the direction comes. So you can see many of the protozoans like Gibbelina or Paradisian, they come towards the light or the food or the sources which provides them biologically significant materials. Or they move away from the noxious stimulus. If you just put some chemicals there, they will move away from there. So the movement or the response get direction, that's the first step. Then you can see chemotaxis, phototaxis is a common behavior seen in these microbes. For chemotaxis means taxis towards chemicals, and phototaxis means taxis towards light, like that. So then what happened that this behavior becomes further complex. So this it will become further complex and it is not a fixed action pattern. So what will happen that if first switch or for a stimulus, animal will show a sequence of behavior. So if you move from the protozoan and polyphora and you move up to the nematodes, the worms, as you know, they start to show certain fixed action patterns. So if you give a stimulus, the animal will start to show some behaviors which will continue and it will continue that sequence. So it will be the world being stopped. And the stimulus is not a sign stimulus. So this is like in the first case, there was only one switch, one light. Here, there is a one switch and many lights, which burns in sequence. So the stimulus which gives or initiate this type of behavior is known as sign stimulus. So it's say the stimulus, if the stimulus is there, the animal will show the complete behavior. So the excellent examples comes from sticklebacks. You may know the fish. Stickleback is the very famous fish, which is used in behavior research. So sticklebacks, the study was conducted by Tim Burgen, who got the Nobel Prize for animal behavior. What they found was that if there is a red color, the fish will show aggressive behaviors. So usually the red color is a sign of a called the rival male, which comes to his territory. So what it will do that the red color can initiate aggressive behaviors in this animal. So even there are stories which says that even the male delivering ram which used to come to the lab of Tim Burgen has initiated this aggressive behavior in this animal. So the next one is gray light goose experiment. So here what we can see that Anything which resembles an egg or a shape of an egg, just like a gold board or anything like an egg, initiate the pulling behavior in this animal. So once you show this egg, beak of the animal will come down, can't come forward, and it will try to move it instead towards it. So the behavior becomes further complicated, and it shows to whatever the egg-shaped object it gets. And the next level, another thing is skeletal sticks. So here what happened that the individuals, the young ones get food from its mother by pecking on a red patch on the bill. So if you show the red patch, whether it may be on beam, whether it may be on a piece of cardboard, whatever it may be, the girl's stick will start to peck. So this stimulus initiates a continuous response in this animal. So this sign stimulus in certain cases works as a supernormal stimulus. Just like we are increasing the voltage in a circuit, what happens that if the stimulus size increases, in certain cases behavior also increases. For example, if you provide a large egg, what will happen that the animal will show more behavior. Or if you show a bright, large, red colored thing, the stickleback will show more aggressive behaviors. So it's just like a simple system with a switch and a terminator. Very simple. So the next one, so here we saw the behaviors are instinct. So the behaviors are born with the animal. And it does not never modify it, and it just behaves or reacts towards the stimulus response variety. It may be complex like that of a chemical's experiment, or it may be just simple as that of a bacteria, that of a protozoan species. So next your system becomes so what you can see that instincts have been shown by organisms ranging from protozoan to human beings. In many cases, many of the behaviors shown by these organisms are instinct, which is coded in their genome or coded in their system. So now the system shows some other variation. Now what it does that it remembers what happened in the previous case. So there comes the learning. So what happened that the system, so you can see, it's from the animals, if you analyze, you can see learning comes a little bit late. Usually the arthropods start showing learning, the signs of learning. So learning is defined as relatively lasting change in the behavior that is a result of an experience. When an animal gets an experience, it remembers what happened there. And it stores that information. And even though the behavior gets transformed due to that information. So you can see the learning from, as we said, even the learning also has the different levels that we will discuss now. And we can see the distribution of learning in different animals, how it is distributed. So learning often leads to memory. The animal remembers that it may be a short-term memory, it will be kept for a very short period, or it will be kept for a very long period. So earlier people believe that the animals, just like fishes also, only have 3-second memory. So there's a famous theory, just like famous talk, saying by saying that fishes are organisms with 3-second memory. But what happened that recent study shows that, no, it's not like that. They also have long-term memories, and they're short-term memory is also very good. They even remembers for years. Just like their friends, they remembers for years. So the memory also started to work on the system of animal now. So now let's examine, yeah.
In previous slides, do you have a reference for the definition of the learning
Encyclopedia of psychologists. I will give you that description. One of the papers which I used to prepare this talk is with me and make a review of again. And then what happened? We are analyzing different types of learning. The simplest form of learning is the habituation. So here what happens that if a stimulus is given in continuous to the animal, what will happen that it will lose the response. So as you know, even this the habituation you can see from the protozoans. If you give a stimulus for long, what happens that protozoan will also start to stop responding to that. So here what you can see that the response will wane as the stimulus will be continuously given to it. So it is said that this system has been controlled by the central nervous system, not by the AGR system, and it is different from sensory adaptation. For example, if we come to a room which contains the smell of a scent, what will happen that after some time we will lose that capacity. So it is not like that. Here it is done by the central nervous system. And as you see, you can see that this learning also gets complex from lower animal towards higher animals. And the lowermost types of learning is also preserved during the course of evolution. So we also show habituation. and now Professor Moore also source association. You can see the fundamental things or the fundamental properties of nerves or neural system or the behavior will be kept in most of the cases. That's why Darwin argued that there will exist continuity for the behaviors in animals and human beings. Then next comes classical conditioning, which you people are more familiar than me. For to just the pressure to memory, I can say that there's a survival reflex on dog. Food is associated with dog. So here the learning system becomes further complicated. Instead of learning the learning, what happens that it tries to associate one stimulus with another stimulus. So you are getting the secondary level of processing here. So one stimulus is being associated with another stimulus. So if you analyze the animal kingdom for this classical conditioning, you can see that it is very difficult, or you can never condition a bacteria, condition a protozoa or a spore response. Or it is very, very difficult to condition a worm. And after insects, the conditioning becomes a little bit possible, because many honeybees may be used. You can condition many honeybees. But in mollusca, when the cephalopod comes in, it shows a good level of conditioning. And if you can condition a fish, that's also very difficult. It is very difficult to condition a fish. They won't learn, or they won't be, they are not that much efficient in associating a stimulus with other thing. And no similar from the fish, but if it comes to the birds, they are very, you can condition them very easily. And mammals, it becomes more and more easy. And in the case of human beings, it's very easy. That's why we can teach our kids. So it becomes more complex through the evolution, as we have discussed here. So in the other case, that is trilateral. So what happened that in the conditioning, the learning was a random, process in which it associated one stimulus with another stimulus only. So it apparently does not change its behavior. So what here, what happened that in instrumental conditioning, what happened that animal gets a stimulus, and that stimulus may be providing negative or positive reinforcement, and that animal will repeat that reinforcement to get that reward again. So here, the animal voluntarily changes or apparently changes the behavior different from the first case, the classical condition. And what here we can see that if you analyze the phylogeny, you can see that from the insects, above insects, in the case of insects also it is very difficult to condition them apparently unless it is some escape routes. But in the case of octopus, they show a lot of operant conditioning. They can learn even, there are studies which show that they can even open the lock if you condition them very well. So above that, in fishes also apparently conditioning is not that much difficult, but it's a bit difficult, but they also can press the lever to get food. Or they also can press the lever to open the door. So above that, what you can see that in reptiles, amphibia and all that, it's very difficult to open condition them because they won't have that much social life and all that thing that we will discuss later. So if you move above that, you can get again, you can condition them. So the next one is embedding. I know most of you may be familiar with this same terms, but what I am trying to do is that I am trying to show the complexity through that phylogeny, how it gets acquired. So in imprinting, what happens is that a young animal develops an attachment towards another animal or object. So simply, how many of you think that human beings have the ability for imprinting? Very few. Okay, human beings also can imprint. So usually it's said that boys get imprinted with the image of mother, and they choose mate based on that. There are studies which show that. So in the case of animals, especially it is seen with precocious animals which woke up just after the birth. So what they do that they just follow the movement of the object which is moving in front of them. So the famous experiments, and one of the famous experiments was done by Conrad Lorenz, as you know. But here there is one thing you can see, it's an offshoot. If you arrange them according to the usual system, you can see that it's almost like a association behavior, but it is associated by genetics and it is associated by nervous system, and it's a permanent thing. Once it happens, it is very difficult to change. So you can't relearn something which is imprinted in the brain. So that happens with the birds also. But they do that, they follow the moving object. And you might have seen in websites and books where Conrad Lorenz walking in front of the birds, and birds, and the young birds following him. And in birds also they imprint, and in the fishes also they show imprinting. In fishes what they do that, just like the human boys and the human exercise, that they also imprint with the image of mother. And most of the study was done in Malawi cichlids. What they found was that these fishes prefers the male